Hi everyone, my name is Wolverleader, and in this video we're going to talk about one of my favorite frameworks to build microservices called Dapr. Now as systems are becoming more distributed, the complexity of building and maintaining these applications increase. It's advisable not to use microservices just for the sake of using microservices, but if you find that you're building an inherently distributed system, using microservices architecture can actually help with the management of all the different services that support your overall application. So what Dapr does, it helps with this by codifying the best practices for building microservices, and it does this through open independent APIs called building blocks. These building blocks enable you to build portable applications using the language or framework that you're most comfortable with, and they're completely independent. So by using Dapr, you can actually migrate your existing applications to a microservices architecture, or you can adopt best practices from the start by using these building blocks and using patterns such as scale in and scale out, resiliency, and independent deployments. Now, Dapr provides distributed building blocks for you to build microservices in a standardized way, and you can use these to deploy to any environment, such as Kubernetes. Each of these building block APIs are independent, meaning that you can use any number of them within your application. I'm going to be producing a whole series that dives into each of these building blocks that Dapr provides, so we'll go into more detail about each one and what they do later. But also alongside these building blocks, Dapr provides cross-cutting APIs that you can use in all of these building blocks, and these are things like resiliency, observability, and security. Now, when we talk about Dapr, it's important to cover the sidecar architecture. You may have heard or have used sidecar architectures before, but in the context of Dapr, Dapr exposes its HTTP and gRPC APIs as a sidecar architecture, either as a container or as a process. This means that within our applications, we don't need to include any Dapr runtime code, making it easier to integrate Dapr into our application, as well as providing separations of duties of the application logic for more support, improved supportability. Now, Dapr can be hosted in a variety of different environments. We can self-host Dapr on Windows and Linux machines for local development. So here, Dapr will run as a separate sidecar process, which we can call via HTTP or gRPC, and each running service will have a Dapr runtime process or a sidecar configured to use Dapr building blocks, such as PubSub and state stores. We can also host Dapr in Kubernetes. So in Kubernetes, Dapr runs as a sidecar container with the application in the same pod. Dapr has a sidecar injector and operator as control plane services that launch Dapr as a sidecar container in the same pod as the service container, as well as providing notifications of Dapr component updates that are provisioned in the cluster. There's also a Dapr Sentry service that acts as a certificate authority that enables mutual TLS between Dapr sidecar instances for secure data encryption. And finally, you can also deploy Dapr control plane services to clusters of virtual or physical machines in production for high availability. So now that we know a little bit about Dapr, let's see how we can get started with Dapr on our local machine. Okay, so now we're going to install Dapr on our machine, and I'm going to install the Dapr CLI. So I'm using a Windows machine, and I've opened up a PowerShell terminal in the Windows terminal. And what I've got here clipped on my clipboard is a prompt that I'm going to use to install the latest Windows Dapr CLI. So I'm going to go ahead and just paste that and then run that. Now I have Dapr detected on my machine already, so that will reinstall Dapr for me. But if you're doing this for the first time, it's going to say that it's installing Dapr for you. And it's going to create this Dapr folder in the C drive for you, and it's going to download the Dapr CLI for you. This might take a little while, so I'll speed up the video. And there we go. So I've got the Dapr CLI. It's been installed successfully. So to verify the installation, let me just clear some space. I'm going to type Dapr-H. And there we go. So there's the output. So Dapr has been installed on this machine, and it's given me some available commands that I can run, along with some flags that I can run using the Dapr CLI. So let me clear this up. And now the next step is to initialize Dapr in our local environment. So remember, Dapr runs as a sidecar alongside your application. And in self-hosted mode, this means that it's a process on our local machine. And by initializing Dapr, we can fetch and install the Dapr sidecar binaries locally and create a development environment that streamlines our application development with Dapr. So what I'm going to do in my terminal, I'm going to type Dapr init. So I'm initializing Dapr for me. So it's going to pull container images from Docker Hub and install the runtime version for me. This might take a little while, so I'll speed up the video. Fantastic. So it's run some containers for me. It's telling me that some containers are running. So when we initialize Dapr, we've got three containers that are going to be running for us. So first one is a Redis container instance that's going to be used as a local state store and message broker. We've got a Zipkin container for observability. We've also got the Dapr placement service container instance for local actor support. And we also have a folder that stores default components and defines our components for our state store and message broker that's available to us. And I'll show you where we can find that in a bit. But let's verify that the containers are running. So what I can do is just go docker ps. And there we go. So I've got these three containers up and running for me. What I can do now is verify that the components directory has been initialized. So what I can do is type explorer. And I'm going to go make sure that's a dollar sign, env, user profile, slash Dapr. There we go, press enter. And that has opened up just on my other screen. Let me get that sorted. And there we go. So there is the folder that Dapr has created when we initialized it. And I've got some components for PubSub and StateStore. We'll dive into these and how they're what that YAML actually looks like when we cover these building blocks in future videos in more detail. But for now, we've got Dapr up and running on our local machine, which is pretty cool. So I'm going to go ahead and clear this. Now that we have Dapr up and running, what we're going to do is we're going to run a Dapr sidecar and try out one of the components. And this one is going to be state management. So the first command we're going to introduce ourselves to is Dapr run. And this command runs our application and a Dapr sidecar. But in this case, we're only running the sidecar since we're going to be interacting with state management locally. So what I can do is give this application an ID. I'm going to call it my app, and I'm going to expose it on an HTTP port 3500. There we go. Press enter. And my Dapr sidecar is up and running. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to open up another terminal. And I'm going to invoke the state store by adding something to it. So what I've got, I'm going to just copy and paste this command into here. And I'm going to save an item in my state store. So I'm just going to save my name, WilTheLeader, in the state store that's defined. Now remember, this is running in Redis or a Redis container that we initialized when we first initialized Dapr. So I'm going to go ahead, press enter. And that's going to be, that's hopefully saved it into my state store. So what I can actually do is use another PowerShell command to retrieve that. And there we go. So I saved my name into the state store, and then I invoked another REST method to retrieve that value from my state store, which is pretty cool. We can also see how Redis is actually storing our information and verify that Dapr is using it as a state store. So I can actually run docker exec into the Dapr Redis container with the Redis CLI. And I'll just have a look at that, not key, keys. And there we go. So app my name. And then what I can do, hget all my app name. And there we go. it's got Will Valida out for me, which is pretty cool. I can go ahead and exit that. I can also delete this from the state store. So go ahead and invoke another method. And then if I try and invoke that again, nothing's been returned. Cool, so that's a very basic example of how we can actually interact with Dapr and interact with state management. In future videos, we'll go into this in more depth and actually use application code to interact with Dapr. So we'll have our application and the Dapr sidecar. In here, we just interact with Dapr via the sidecar. So let's wrap this up. So that wraps up this video. In this video, we took our first steps into Dapr, we got it running on our local machine, and we interacted with the Dapr sidecar for the first time. In our next video, we'll take a look at our first building block in Dapr, service invocation, and how we can build applications that use the service invocation building block. So if you like this video, give it a like. If you have any questions on Dapr, please ask in the comments below. And if you want to see more Dapr videos, don't forget to subscribe. No matter where you are in the world, I hope you're having a great day, and we will see you all next time.